regarding applying these ideas to New Zealand, in these workshops you've been urging New Zealanders to consider whether their cities could become living cities. And I wanted to touch on two very different examples that we have here. On the one hand, we have Auckland, the super city, which is being organized and developed for very large-scale political and economic reasons. And then on the other hand, we have Christchurch, which is recovering from this major disaster and needs to be rebuilt as quickly and safely as possible. How would you approach these two different situations?
Well, I think they're uniquely different situations, and I would say that the third major city, Wellington, is also in a different category as well. Each city, I think, presents unique challenges to becoming better planned, more sustainable, more community-oriented, all those desirable goals that I think that are a part of the living city model. And but for Auckland, it's really a challenge in terms of governance, the structure, restructuring of governance, and now that it has been amalgamated into a super city, encompassing the what I believe is the seven former councils of the Auckland Greater Auckland area, they now have a bigger challenge of saying, how do we deliver services? How do we provide all those services and related factors to the city when we're organizing it from a completely different perspective, which is this large entity. On the other hand, I think the big challenge is how do you continue to have a city that is a city of a collection of communities? Because great cities, are not monolithic across the board. They have different neighborhoods, they have different ethnic enclaves, they have different qualities to the different neighborhoods, and I think that will be the bigger challenge facing Auckland now, is how to continue to honor the local aspect of living in Auckland while at the same time trying to be more efficient at a larger scale. It's a very big challenge. I know they are undergoing planning for that, and they have incorporated some very visionary elements into their planning, and I was really pleased to hear about that when during my visit to Auckland. Christchurch is a very different situation. And in fact, at the bequest of the New Zealand Futures Trust, I authored an article on planning for Christchurch in the aftermath of natural disaster that was published in the most recent issue of their publication, Future Times, which can be found at the New Zealand Futures Trust website. And in that article, I posited a series of questions that basically go like this, that the typical response to natural disaster in large cities is rescue, recovery, and rebuilding. That's the three phases of planning or responding to natural disaster and major crises, such as the earthquake that hit Christchurch. I've been in Christchurch, and I know that they, from what I've seen and heard, they're doing a pretty good job, beginning to recover from that disaster and to rethink what that city can be, to get services back into working shape, to deal with neighborhoods that potentially will no longer be habitable. So it's a huge task, and from what I can tell, they're doing a very good job. However, saying that, at the same time, I would say that I think there's another challenge looming out there, and that is the ultimate replanning of Christchurch for the next 50 to 100 years. And the thesis that I propose in my article is that long-range planning is really the fourth stage of recovery from a major natural disaster. So it's rescue, recovery, rebuilding, and replanning or revisioning, if you will. And that, I think, remains to be seen how Christchurch will do. On the other hand, I know there's lots of pressure from the central government in terms of their recovery agency that is charged with directing the recovery effort, and it's only natural that there could be a tension between those two processes, the one of planning for the future of the city and the other one dealing with the most urgent needs. They shouldn't be incompatible, but I can already see that there is some tension there, and my word of caution to the people of Christchurch, if they were to ask me, is to don't give up that pursuit of rethinking what that city will be in another 10, 25, or 50 years as you rebuild. Because on one hand, you can try to recreate what was there, which I think will be extremely difficult to do because so much has been lost and cannot be created. And on the other hand, this is, even though it might be painful to think of it at this time, this is a golden opportunity to rethink the whole of the city, because very few cities get this chance to have something of a clean slate to be thinking about how they organize themselves at precisely the time that we're worried about peak oil and reorganizing the way we move around a city. At the same time, we're thinking about climate change and how will we deal with, for example, rising sea levels and climate change and the impact on all that. This is the perfect time for Christchurch to be thinking longer term and down the road. And my advice to both the central and the local governments is to not discard public aspirations for what their city can be in the future and to incorporate that into how they respond to the current crisis. Mm-hmm.